So we have seen two kinds of collections so far, lists and dictionaries. So a list keeps a sequence of values. It's very useful for accumulating things as we go along. But one of the disadvantages of using a list is that it does not support what is called random access. So we cannot look at an arbitrary element at the list without walking to it from the beginning. So if you want a value in a list which is at a position I, then you have no option except to start at the 0th position and walk right until you hit the ith position. So this is a list. Then we said that if we really want random access, we will assume that we have another kind of a collection called a dictionary. So in a dictionary, we store values not by position but by key. So a dictionary is a collection of key value pairs. The keys can be arbitrary values, and the assumption is that whenever we want the value associated with the key, it will take the same amount of time regardless of the size of the dictionary and which key we choose. So this is what we call random access. It really doesn't depend on what you are looking for, whereas in the list, depending on the position that you are looking for, it will take less or more time. So now we want a third type of collection, which we call a matrix, right? So a matrix is what you would have seen in school. It's just a two-dimensional table with rows and columns. So each row is of the same length. So in general, for instance, you may have m rows and n columns. And the way that we will index these rows and columns is by using numbers from 0 to m minus 1 for the rows and 0 to n minus 1 for the columns. So this is a convention that is often used in computing. Normally, when you are using it in mathematics, you will normally number them 1 to n and 1 to m. But it's very standard to number things starting from 0, so we will just follow this convention. So if we have m rows, the rows are numbered 0 to m minus 1. And if we have n columns, the columns are numbered 0 to n minus 1. So we will use the square bracket notation. So if matrix is such a matrix, so matrix is the name of a variable which stores such a matrix, then to get the value at row I and column j, we will use this double square bracket. So notice that this is a slightly different from maybe what you might intuitively think, which is to use a pair of indices within a single square bracket. So we will use this double square bracket, which says that in matrix I, the row I, the jth element. So the question now is, how would we implement this? Do we need some new concepts in order to use matrices for our work? So we already have a collection which supports random access, namely a dictionary. So an easy way to implement matrices for our purpose is just to assume that they are special kinds of dictionaries. So in particular, we can think of a matrix as a nested dictionary. At the top level, the keys correspond to the rows. So I have keys 0 to m minus 1, which correspond to the rows. And for each of these keys, the value is another dictionary with keys 0 to n minus 1. So here is how we would create a matrix with a given set of rows and a given set of columns. So we pass the argument how many rows I want and how many columns I want. Then I start with an empty dictionary, which I will call mat, and I start with the 0th row. So for each row, I first create the empty dictionary that will store the row. So basically, we are saying that each row is itself a dictionary, right? So we have this dictionary mat, which has keys 0 to m minus 1. And then each of these is itself a dictionary, which has keys 0 to n minus 1. So the first thing I do for each row is I will create this empty dictionary corresponding to that row. And now, for each column, that is for j from 0 to n minus 1, or in this case cols minus 1, since cols is the number of columns I want, I will create this key and I will increment the column so that I will go to the next column, and then I will stop. And finally, when I am done with this row, I will increment the row. Right? So this is just a straightforward nested loop again. So row by row, I will create the dictionary for that row, and for each row, column by column, I will create a key for that row and that column. Right? So this is my procedure, create matrix, which can then be used in a matrix form, because now I can provide any argument ij, and because these are just dictionaries, the ijth entry will take an equal amount of time by the property that we have assumed for dictionaries. So when I want to create a matrix, I will just pass two numbers, the number of rows I want and the number of columns I want, and create matrix will create this next nested dictionary and give it back to me, and I assign it to be a variable like this. So my matrix is create matrix 30, 45. So now I have row indices 0 to 29, column indices 0 to 44. So the way we normally deal with matrices is to process them systematically, either row by row or column by column. So for instance, we might want to say for each row in my matrix and for each column in my matrix, do something with the element I, j at row I and column j. We could also do it the other way around. We could also say for every column in my matrix and for every row in my matrix. So basically, instead of processing it row by row, I'm processing it column by column. It depends on the application, which one you want to do. But both of these are natural operations to perform on a matrix. So what we would like is some easy way to do this. So we want to have a way, for example, of iterating through the rows. Now remember that the row indices are just the keys of the outer dictionary. Remember, it's an outer extended, it's a nested dictionary. So, I have matrix of I of j. So, matrix of I, those keys are actually the row indices. And then within each matrix of I, there are keys 0 to n minus 1, which are the column indices. So, I can iterate through the row indices and the column indices. So, this would be one way to do this, right? So, for every r, for every row in the keys of my matrix, for every column in the keys of the zeroth row of my matrix. So remember, all the rows have the same size, right? So this is one assumption, that this is a rectangular matrix. It doesn't matter whether I pick up 0 or 1 or any other row, but I know that if it's a non-empty matrix, it has at least one row, and if that one row exists, it will have index 0. So it's safe to pick up index 0. So for every row in the keys of my matrix and for every column in the keys of the first row of that matrix, do something with the entry r, c at that point. Right? So, this more or less corresponds to what we were intuitively saying over here. Okay? But there is a small problem, and the small problem is that these keys need not come in the order that we expect. So, when we said that keys of a dictionary returns the list of keys, we did not specify that these keys come in any particular order. They may not even be in the order in which they were inserted, and they are certainly not expected to be sorted in any particular order. However, when we are processing a matrix, it is natural to go from the first row to the last row and from the first column to the last column. So we would like these keys to come in that order, 0 to m minus 1 for the rows, 0 to n minus 1 for the column. So that is easily done, provided we have at our disposal, if you remember, we wrote in one of our earlier lectures on lists, we wrote insertion sort. So we could write a variety of such procedures. So let us assume we have a procedure called sort, which will take a list and return an ascending order list in sorted order, right? So all now we need to do is to take this list of keys that is produced by the keys function and pass it through sort, and now I'm okay. If I say for every row in the sorted list of keys of my matrix and for every column in the sorted list of keys of the column of row 0, do something, then I'm guaranteed that I'm processing the rows in the correct sequence and the columns in the correct sequence. So this is an implementation that we could use, but because we are going to use it all the time, it's a bit tedious to write the sort and keys and all that. So to improve readability, we will just use rows and columns as a kind of shortcut to refer to those values, sorted keys of my matrix. So basically, I'm going to replace this complicated expression by this simpler expression, right? So rows of my matrix will always be sort of keys of my matrix. Columns of my matrix will always be sort of keys of my matrix 0. But if I do it this way, then when I'm using a matrix, it's very transparent what I'm doing. I'm going through the rows or I'm going through the columns. I'm not lost in this notation of sorting and keys and all that. So we will use this notation, right? So for each row in the rows of my matrix, for each column in the columns of my matrix, do something with my matrix at row, c, right? And as before, we can invert this now. Because these entries exist. So it's not that these entries have to be created. Remember that when we created a matrix, we actually created every key, right? So we created every key, and in fact, we also initialized it to 0. This is a point I forgot to mention, but create matrix creates every key I, j. So there are no missing keys, and every I, j entry is actually assigned a value 0 to start with, because that's more or less how we are going to use it. So it's useful to combine the creation and the initialization in one step. That's what we did. Right? So my matrix 0 always exists, so I can as well process the columns before the rows. There is no problem of whether my matrix 0, this value, my matrix 0 is defined or not, because it is defined. So I can just say for C in columns, for R in rows, do something. So this is now a complete introduction to how we are going to use matrices. So, we're going to use this create matrix with, we're always going to use only two-dimensional matrices, by the way. So, we're going to pass two arguments, the rows and the columns numbers, to create a matrix. And then once we have a matrix, we can use this for each in rows and for each in columns in order to systematically process the matrix from beginning to end. Okay, so to summarize, a matrix is just a two-dimensional table. And what we are basically going to exploit is that accessing any mij value in this whole table takes the same amount of time. So these are random access collections. And because they are random access collections and we don't want to create a new concept, we have just implemented them for simplicity using dictionaries. So these are actually dictionaries with special keys. The keys are 0 to m minus 1 and 0 to n minus 1. And we have defined these. Again, this is just a convenience. We can write it in terms of the dictionary underlying it. But for convenience, we have defined these new iterator like keys of D. We have defined rows of M and columns of, this should be M, columns of M, right? As new functions which will return us in sorted order the indices corresponding to the rows and the columns. So the indices are always 0 to row minus 1, the last row is or m minus 1 if there are m rows, 0 to n minus 1, and this rows of m and columns of m will always give us the keys in that order. Right? What we will see is that matrices are very useful to represent graphs, which we had encountered in our lectures as a way of representing relationships.